This is Christopher with AG Productions, and welcome to this week's edition of Ask a Painter, where we answer some of the more frequently asked questions that we receive through comments, PMs, and emails here at AG Productions. The first question on the list is something that has not really been asked, but maybe once or twice, but I think it's something we need to get into because it involves conventions, and convention season is, boom, right around the corner. Starts here in March, doesn't end until about mid to late September, usually. Gen Con's the last one, or the last big one, really, of the year. So, as far as conventions, let's just jump right in. Basically, what I was asked was, what's your take on it? Do you have any tips? What to expect, etc. Alright, so, I'm just going to throw some stuff out there. Hopefully you like it. If not, oh well, whatever. And then, we got one more question after that, and hopefully we can knock it out before the 15-minute mark. But, anyway, as far as conventions go. I'll just give you a few tips, and then if you got any more questions, feel free to put them in the comment section down below, and we'll go from there. But tip number one, bring a lot of clothing with you, all right? A lot of people will tell you that conventions are very warm. Now, part of this has to do with the fact that, you know, a lot of gamers have a little bit more body mass than me. So they got a little bit more insulation, if you know what I'm talking about. But beyond that, I mean, here's what's going to happen. You've got a room, and you're standing in it. Let's say the room right now is 65 degrees. Pretty comfortable temperature. You pack in 4,000 more people, and that room temperature automatically goes up to about 90 degrees. Okay? That's the theory behind people saying to dress lightly when you go to a convention. And I've heard that many times before. Here's what I've found is actually the real case, though, when you get into some of the larger conventions. At some of the smaller ones, yes, that may be the way things work. But at some of the larger ones, when you're working with 10, 12, 14, 15, even 30,000 people, here's what you're looking at. The people who run the convention know about body heat, all right? So they know that the more people that come into the convention, the hotter it's going to be. And so what they're going to do is they're going to crank those thermostats down as far as they can go. I've been in conventions before where there have been about 15,000 people, and I would venture to guess, that the temperature in the room was about 45 degrees. It is like ice in there a lot of times. And so if you want to dress cool, you can do that. But take some extra clothing with you just in case the convention people are actually smart enough to cut the air conditioner on. Some conventions, they won't do it because they don't want the extra expense. But a lot of them, the better ones, they're gonna crank that air down, and you're going to end up like a block of ice before the day's over if you don't have several layers of clothing to dress in. All right, so take multiple styles of clothes and multiple layers of clothes with you just in case. All right, now, let's talk about buying stuff. You're at a convention, there's dealers all over the place, and you're walking around, you've bought a bunch of stuff, but guess what? All you got your arms. So now you got to go all the way back to your hotel room or all the way back to the car, and you got to lug all this stuff with you, and you got to go all the way back to the convention. It's just a pain in the butt. Take some kind of satchel, a backpack, a briefcase, a tote bag, something that you can carry all your goodies in. Okay? It's just going to make things a lot easier on you throughout the day. Okay? Now, let's jump into, let's see, what can we go to next? How about, oh, this is a good one. This is one I've drawn flak for in the past, but I don't care. I'm more interested in giving you guys the truth than I am in making people like us. So, yeah, let's just jump right into it. When you're at a convention, don't expect anybody to know who you are. Despite your fame and or fortune, let's just face it, the odds of running into somebody that knows you and or who you are and or what you do are unbelievably slim. I mean, really tiny. I've run into people at conventions before, and I've had people email me when I've mentioned their names online, and, you know, if I run into them at a convention, shake their hand, you know, say, hey, who are you, what do you do? And immediately they become offended. Same thing happens here online when I say something like, you know, this person is, you know, I've heard of this person, but I don't know anything about them. And actually got, I'll give you an example. Some of you may remember I did a thing about which classes to take at Adepticon. One of the instructors, who I had never heard of before, actually sent me an email and said, I can't give you the exact quote because it was kind of mean, but basically what the gist of the email was, and I quote, "How dare you never have heard of me? I'm a 14-time Golden Demon winner. I am awesome." Oh, yeah. And so, you can see the ridiculousness of it, but the idea is this, guys. Look, you go to conventions not so you can impress people. You go to a convention to meet a bunch of people that you've never met before, to have fun, to gain some new friends, and to just overall have a good time. If you go with the intention of trying to impress people or trying to sort of stroke your own ego by having as many people come up to you as you can find that know who you are, you're going to be really, really disappointed. I'm personally shocked anytime somebody comes up to me at a convention and says, "Hey, I like your stuff on YouTube." I'm like, "Really? I didn't figure anybody would be through here that actually watched my stuff." Because the odds of, you know, one out of the 3,800 subscribers or so that we've got actually showing up at a convention, fairly slim. So just be aware, guys, that you're going in as a normal person and you're around a bunch of other normal people. And that we're all human. We all put our pants on the same way, except for those who, you know, hold them like this and jump off the bed and get both legs in at the same time every morning. But just realize that we're all on equal ground, okay? It's going to make your experience much, much better. You're going to have a lot more fun. And you're just going to enjoy yourself and the convention a lot more, okay? Now, the last one is the one that I really am going to get bitten for, but again, I don't care because it doesn't matter. The truth is what matters, not making somebody feel good, okay? Here's what it is. Accommodations. Now, what do you mean, Christopher? I'm talking about where are you staying when you go to a convention. And I can attest to both sides of this. I have been on the attendee side of a convention, and I have also been on the hosting side of a convention. I'll give you the hosting side first so you can understand where I'm coming from and why I'm going to tell you what I'm going to tell you. If you ever host a convention or a seminar or something like that, you're going to call a hotel and you're going to say, "Hey, I want to rent your ballroom or whatever room they've got that can hold the number of people that you're going to have your event for." And they're going to give you a rate. And let's say that rate is, let's go for a smaller convention, a smaller room that's going to hold, say, 150 people. That would be generally on the order of about $2,000, okay? And if you want a larger convention, let's say you're going to Gen Con or something like that, you're renting a whole civic center or arena, you're talking somewhere on the order of $70,000 to $80,000, a little bit larger. All right, so and sometimes even much bigger than that. I know that the arena here in Birmingham, if I'm not mistaken, I believe their daily rate is, I want to say it's like $175,000 or something like that. But the arena can hold 40,000 people. So it really depends on the size of the venue. But anyway, let's just make it real simple and say it's $1,000. Okay, make it real nice and easy. All right. The hotel's then going to ask you how many people are coming and how many rooms can you fill. All right. In other words, they want to know people coming from out of state, out of town, how many people are going to be staying at their hotel. All right. And if you tell them that the number of people coming in can take up, say, 75% of their occupancy, then what they're going to do is they're going to say, "Okay, you're not going to pay $1,000 for the room. You're going to pay, you know, $400. So you're going to get a significant discount for being able to fill up the rooms at the place where you're going, at the hotel where you're going. All right? Now, a lot of times it doesn't work on a strict discount. Sometimes it works like this. You book the rooms up front. Let's say I want to hold a seminar. and I know that there's going to be, you know, 300 people come in. I'm going to rent 300 rooms for however many nights that's going to be. And I'm going to pay for that up front. Plus, I'm going to pay for the cost of the convention room up front, the ballroom up front, okay? And then what's going to happen is if those 300 rooms get filled, then they give me back the cost for those rooms, plus they give me a little bit of discount on the convention center. All right, so it works several different ways, but the idea is this, guys. You book a room, a ballroom type place at a hotel, you're going to be advertising that hotel as the place where you want people to stay because you want your discount. All right, I've been there. I know how it works. All right, now, that's why when you see a lot of times on websites, on flyers and things like that for conventions, it'll say something like, recommended hotel, and it happens to be the one where the convention is at, special rate. And it'll be, you know, $149 a night instead of $179 a night, okay? Well, you are getting a special rate. There's no doubt about that. Here's what's the doubtful part, or the slightly shady part. What they don't expect you to do is go and do research. All right, and this is where I'm going to piss a bunch of people off. But again, I don't care because the truth is truth. When you look for your accommodations for any convention, you need to look not at the sales presentation the people who are hosting a convention are giving you. You need to figure out where that convention is being held, and you need to get on Expedia, Travelocity, Orbitz, any one of the good travel sites, and you need to look for hotels in the surrounding area. Because what's going to happen is you're going to find something like this. And I'll give you a perfect example. Last year's Adepticon, I did this, and it worked wonderfully. All right? Last year at Adepticon, if I am not mistaken, and I don't believe I am, the room rate at the hotel where Adepticon was being held was $129 a night, which is not a bad deal considering their normal rate was like $159 a night, okay? So it's like 30, 40 bucks off, okay? Good deal compared to the normal rate of that hotel. Was it a good deal compared to the surrounding hotels? Absolutely not. It was a horrible deal. And I'll give you a perfect example. I got on Expedia because I love Expedia. They're, for me, the cheapest travel site out there. And I was able to find a hotel that was literally less than a mile away from the convention center. So if I didn't have the ability to rent a car while I was up there, I'm still okay. If I had a car, I could have gone out even farther. And, I mean, heck, even a mile's drive, it's going to take 3 minutes every day. Okay? Where I stayed, nice hotel. It was a Courtyard by Marriott. $69 a night. A $60 savings over what I would have paid just to have the convenience of not having to get in a car and drive a mile or walk a mile, okay? I'm telling you guys, you can have a significant amount of savings if you will just look around at an alternate place to stay when you go to a convention. Now, that being said, this is the warning to you because of that. Let's assume that those rooms that the convention runner or the person putting on the convention don't get filled. Okay, let's say they've booked 300-400 rooms in that hotel and those rooms don't get filled. That person who's hosting the convention eats that cost. Now, you combine that over several years and it's going to get to the point where the convention disappears. So, you do have a toss-up. Do you want to save money, or do you want to support the convention and hope that it goes, or hope that it keeps going? Now, again, I would like to argue this point, though. There will always be people who are willing to stay at the hotel just because they don't want to look around, okay? So there's a sort of a balance between those who are going to go look and those who won't. And as long as that balance stays fine, then you're okay. The convention survives, and you get another year of it. if the convention, if the, the balance is off and more people start looking for outside hotels, then one of two things is going to happen. Either the convention is going to stop happening, or they're going to have to find a different venue and have a bunch of sponsor hotels around that venue and have that venue at someplace other than a hotel where you can't actually book a room, whether it be some sort of convention center, a civic center, whatever the case may be, an arena, a stadium. You know, there's a lot of different options. So just be aware, guys, that if you want to look around and find some cheaper accommodations, you can do that, okay? And it's a possibility, and I personally would recommend doing it. I've gone to a lot of conventions and a lot of seminars, and almost every single time I go, I find a far superior deal on Expedia or Travelocity than I will ever get from the people actually hosting the convention. I'll give you another example. I was in Atlanta about 4 years ago, going to a seminar called Millionaire Mind. And this guy, T. Harvecker, had booked about 8 different hotels right around the, the Georgia World Conference Center or something like that. It's where they held the Olympics. And basically, each one of these hotels in that surrounding area was about $140 a night, which was not bad. I was able, on Expedia or Travelocity, I don't remember which one I used at the time, to find a Hilton hotel, a really nice Hilton hotel, about 4 miles outside of where their little convention was being held, and I think I paid $75 a night for it. $75, $80 in savings. It's amazing what you can save, guys, if you're just willing to do a little bit of research. Now, what can you do with that? You can either put it in your pocket and save it, or if you want to support the convention you're going to, you can go into the dealer's room and you can take, let's use the example last year from Adepticon, I saved $60 a night. There's 4 nights worth of stay there, basically. So I have $240 that I can spend at some of the dealer's booths, all right? Those dealers, they make more money. Guess what? They're coming back next year, all right? Dealers that don't make any money, guess what? They don't come back, all right? There's conventions I've been to where I haven't made a dime. Guess what? I'm not going back to those conventions, all right? And so the more money the dealers make, the odds are they're going to come back again. And the more dealers that actually want to do a convention, the more likely that convention is to stick around, okay? So there's always a trade-off, guys, but I'm telling you, look around for accommodations and things like that because you can save a lot of money. That's it for tips on conventions and stuff like that. We've gone about 18 minutes now. I think that'll be enough for right now. I'll do another smallish episode of Ask a Painter because there is one more question I'd like to address, but I don't want to do it in this video because, like I said, we've already gone too far. Or, not too far, but we've gone for a lengthy amount of time. And, you know, 30-minute videos, they're nice, but they can get a little old. And so we'll stop it right here. And probably tomorrow I'll upload another edition of Ask a Painter. And it'll answer another question that we seem to be getting about 6 or 7 times a week now. But anyway, that's it for today, guys. I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope it's been somewhat enlightening. If you have any questions, feel free to put them down there in the comment section down below. Again, I've been on both sides of the coins, both a hoster and an attendee, so I can pretty much answer just about anything you've got as far as questions regarding conventions. Thank you. If you have any other questions that you would like addressed here on Ask a Painter, again, put those in the comment section down below, and we'll possibly get to those in a future episode. But that's it for today, guys. I hope you've enjoyed it. I hope it's been enlightening. God bless you all. Have a wonderful rest of the day, and I'll see you all in the next video.